In the early 1950s, science fiction television was aimed at kids. I'm Dean Kane. On Saturday mornings, those kids lucky enough to even own a television set were spellbound by the thrilling exploits of space heroes like Flash Gordon and Buck Rogers. Kids didn't care that the spaceships and space weapons looked more like kitchen utensils or that the costumes were corny. To them, the early space television shows were a window to worlds beyond, and they gladly looked on. Influenced by the success of science fiction radio and film in the 30s and 40s, television launched its own brand of hero. Here is a short sample of what you might find on Saturday mornings in the 1950s.
Space Patrol! High adventure in the wild, vast reaches of space. Missions of daring in the name of interplanetary justice. Travel into the future with Buzz Corey, Commander-in-Chief of...
Android, attack. Android, attack.
From here, Corey, you go no place at all. As I said, Corey, from here, you go no place at all.
Captain Video!
Captain Video to Sam Street. Captain Video to Sam Street. I read you. Over.
Calling Captain Video aboard the Galaxy.
This is Captain Video. What is it, Street?
This is Sam Street aboard the Orion.
Yes, I read you, Everett. How did you manage to get free?
Let's not play games, questions, and answers, Captain. All I want from you is the answer to one question.
How is Captain Video going to feel when he learns that I, Dr. Foley, his bitterest enemy, has also reached the outer limit.
Tom Corbett, Space Cadet.
Hi, gang. You know, this new rocket scout we're about to speed test is really something.
Space Academy, USA, in the year 2354 AD. The world beyond tomorrow.
Hi, Tom. Roger, I didn't know you fellas were aboard this ship.
Just having a look around. What are you doing here?
Same thing. She's a beautiful ship, isn't she?
Sure is.
I can hardly wait for the speed trial tomorrow.
3, 2, 1, 0!
So until next fall, when we hope to blast off with you again, spaceman's luck to you all.
Okay, Venus?
Okay, Steve.
Right. Let's go.
Kids' television in the early 60s came with strings attached. Puppets were launched into outer space with the help of a process called super marionation.
I know now why they call you the greatest astronaut on Space Patrol.
I think you're cute, too. Space Patrol, this is Fireball XL5 returning to base. Mission complete. Over and out.
By 1965, science fiction on Saturday mornings took one small step for kids and one giant step for their parents when the first soap opera of the space age landed in prime time. Inspired by the children's classic Swiss Family Robinson, Irwin Allen's first television series became a kind of Space Family Robinson.
Truly inspiring.
6, 5, 4.
Based on the premise that Earth is too crowded, the family is sent on the first mission to colonize other worlds. Unfortunately, their mission is sabotaged by a stowaway who tampers with the family robot.
Hey, what are you doing there? You're not supposed to do that.
Destroy!
Well, of course, we don't know how far you...
For several celestial seasons, we were all lost in space as the pioneering Robinsons wandered from planet to planet trying to find their way home.
Warning!
Warning!
Don!
As of this moment, the spacecraft has passed the limits of our galaxy, hopelessly lost in space.
Affirmative.
By 1966, if you really wanted to try something different, there was a little-noticed action-adventure space western. One early review in Variety referred to this space western as dreary and confusing, concluding that the show was better suited to Saturday morning. Viewers who tuned in on Thursday nights felt otherwise.
Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Its five-year mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
It's been said that few ideas in the history of television have inspired more passion and allegiance than Star Trek, which was created by Gene Roddenberry. Week after week, devoted viewers were intrigued by the multicultural crew and enticed by the show's optimistic view of the future, which reflected the idealism of the 60s.
Star Trek went to the heart of trying to do very good science fiction and have the ensemble cast and the common background every week so that you felt like voyaging with this particular family of people because they got into the most interesting adventures.
You've got my ship and I want it back.
Commanding the USS Enterprise is James T. Kirk. An impetuous guy with guts and compassion.
Feel my way. Make absolutely sure.
Spock here.
His first officer is Mr. Spock.
I have a human half, you see, as well as an alien half, submerged, constantly at war with each other.
A no-nonsense alien, half human, half Vulcan, who is loyal, logical, and likable.
Fascinating.
Each week, viewers voyaged beyond their wildest dreams.
What are you?
I am the guardian of forever.
A time portal, Captain. A gateway to other times and dimensions.
Exploring new planets and new civilizations.
All right, Spock, you have all the answers. What now?
Omega, your tone is increasingly hostile.
My tone isn't the only thing that's hostile, Mr. Spock.
Curious. Most illogical.
And I'm sick and tired of your logic.
We could use a little inspiration.
But a little less analysis and more action.
Get us off, Scott. We should be moving, but we're not.
What are you doing?
Our boosters.
We'll never be able to hold orbit.
Would you rather stay here?
No, Mr. Spock.
No, I won't kill you.
No, I won't kill him. Do you hear?
You're a Metron?
By sparing your helpless enemy, who surely would have destroyed you, you demonstrated the advanced trait of mercy. Something we hardly expected. We feel that there may be hope for your kind. Therefore, you will not be destroyed. It would not be civilized.
No matter what civilizations the crew of the Enterprise discovered, or obstacles they encountered, fans could always count on close encounters of another kind.
All this power surging and throbbing, yet under control. Are you like that, Captain?
For this evening, I was told I am your slave.
You must know what you're doing.
You are here because I wished you here.
I do not wish to see you tortured in any way.
had one serious love relationship in his life, and that was with Edith Keeler. In a past he couldn't change, so he lost her.
In the award-winning episode City on the Edge of Forever, Kirk and Spock travel back in time to Earth in an attempt to put history back on track.
We seem to be costumed a little out of step with the time.
I'm afraid I'm going to be difficult to explain in any case, Captain.
It is here that Kirk falls in love with a woman who must die if history is to resume its natural course.
What are your names?
Mine's Jim Kirk. His is Spock.
I'm Edith Keeler.
I find her most uncommon, Mr. Spock.
I saw her obituary. Some sort of traffic accident. This is how history went after McCoy changed it. With the A-bomb, and with their V-2 rockets to carry them, Germany captured the world. And all this because McCoy came back and somehow kept her from dying in a street accident, as she was meant to.
I believe I'm in love with Edith Keeler.
Jim, Edith Keeler must die.
June 3rd, 1969, Star Trek's original mission ended.
Warp 1, Mr. Sulu.
Their mission continued in reruns, and soon everybody knew what their devoted fans had known all along. That Star Trek would become the cosmic cornerstone by which all other science fiction shows would be measured. Well, that was some ride from Captain Video to Captain Kirk, but we're not stopping here. Don't get up, stay strapped in your seats, because we'll be back with more of the best of science fiction on television. Up next, Carrie Fisher with the nuts and bolts of robots on television.
Will you let that dial alone?
Warning, warning. Robots are not toys for kids. I am the Lost in Space robot. We robots are functional beings capable of independent action.
I'm Carrie Fisher. Robots always seem to be stealing the show. My friends from Star Wars, R2-D2 and C-3PO, proved to be among the most memorable characters in the movie. Robots are our creations. When they get out of hand, we can turn them off. Or so we hope.
The more I see of people, the less I get used to them. As I was saying before my wavelength was interrupted, will you let that dial alone?
Hi, Reject. Oh, my gosh, I've never been so glad to see anybody in my entire life.
I want a vacation.
This is a gadget, an automatic man, a very useful experimental machine. What can this machine do? Handle dangerous chemicals, or touch live wires without ever getting hurt. Someday soon, we'll have an automatic man around the house.
I am only wires and cold metal parts.
The first major robot star in a television series was our friend, the robot, from Lost in Space.
You're more than a machine.
You're our friend.
My computers are deeply affected.
Each week, he'd come to the aid of the Robinson family.
You sure are acting funny.
Warning! Immediate danger.
What kind of danger?
My sensors will not accept the possibility of its existence.
Confronting rogues, rascals, even Robbie the robot. one of the most famous robots of all time.
Correction, not robot, robotoid.
It is time we talk. In comparison to myself, you are very ignorant.
The Robinsons belong to me. I will not give up my family.
In a short while, I will be indispensable to them.
You are mistaken. Your efforts will be denied by me.
You are even more stupid than I first computed. Foolish, sad machine.
The series, The Outer Limits, explored the more serious side of robots. For the first time, television examined the problems that happen when man plays God and invents a living machine.
Run, Johnny, run.
I'm teaching him to think, to reason, to perform, but he's still a creation, a machine.
In this highly acclaimed episode, a robot is falsely accused of turning against its creator and murdering him.
Dr. Link, you should not try to fix things. That is what you have me for.
It moves, it talks, it's human. Wait a minute, that's what we need? Counsel for the defense. It'll be the story of the year, the state versus Adam Link. First all-functional robot. Thinks, talks, acts. Accused of murder.
Aren't we rushing pell-mell without responsibility towards some dreadful catastrophe? It's an unreasoning piece of destructive machinery and never will be properly mastered. I don't think we should let such a force loose on the earth.
The court finds the defendant guilty as charged.
The defendant is to be destroyed then?
It is so ordered.
There's the wagon. Story.
That terrible monster won't harm anybody ever again.
It's not the end of the story. It's just the beginning.
From these early Tin Man days, robots on television have become more sophisticated. Programs now explored something new, the evolution of man into machine. The price tag? $6 million.
Steve Austin, astronaut. A man barely alive.
Gentlemen, we can rebuild him. We have the technology. We have the capability to make the world's first bionic man.
Bionics. Man as machine. The year is 1974, and Lee Majors plays secret agent Steve Austin, crime fighter, hero, and all-around athlete. Each week, Austin proved the notion that science was capable of turning man into Superman. By 1975, Austin got a companion, played by Lindsay Wagner, the Bionic Woman.
Wow!
Bionics took one step further in RoboCop.
Hands above your head. You are under arrest.
A syndicated television show based on the hit movie. Set in the near future, a fatally wounded policeman is transformed into a virtually indestructible robot whose powers seem unlimited.
He's online.
The program offers an intriguing dilemma in science fiction. A robot with an identity crisis. The body may be robotic, but the memories and soul are clearly human.
Whoa, RoboCop! You're my hero. When I grow up, I'm gonna be just like you.
When I grow up, I'm gonna be just like you, Dad.
You were thinking about him again, weren't you?
Images are all that's left of what I was.
I want to remember.
Max Headroom turned robotics inside out. His adventures take us into a strange techno future where a TV reporter's memories are trapped in a computer and reincarnated as a smart-alecky talking head.
Mama. Mama. Mama.
You're talking to me, Mr. Grossberg?
Max.
I think it's calling me Mama.
What is that?
Mama. Computer-generated Edison Carter. For the moment, there's only enough memory buffer to generate his head. Too many coordinates for the rest of his body. But you're looking at the future, Mr. Grossberg. People translated as data.
Enter data now.
Beyond Max Headroom, Data from Star Trek, The Next Generation. Flesh and bolts. The total, complete, functioning android. A machine with all the right parts except one, emotion.
Lieutenant DeSora just gave me what could be considered a very passionate kiss in the torpedo bay.
Really? And?
I was intrigued.
Well? What do you think of her, Data?
I find her to be a competent officer, highly motivated, though somewhat lacking in her understanding of the theory underlying the dilithium matrix application.
I meant personally.
I look forward to the time we spend together.
Well, then it seems the next move is yours.
But I am not capable of love.
Then it's going to be a very unique experience.
And like humans, even an android questions his own existence.
May I ask you a question, sir?
Certainly.
Why did you create me?
Why does a painter paint? Why does a boxer box? Now let me ask you a question. Why are humans so fascinated by old things?
Perhaps for humans, old things represent a tie to the past.
But what's so important about the past?
Humans are mortal. They seem to need a sense of continuity. I suppose it is a factor in the human desire to procreate.
Oh, so you believe that having children gives humans a sense of immortality, do you?
It is a reasonable explanation to your query, sir.
Yours as well, Data.
The evolution of television robots has come full circle. From cute and innocent,
it does not compute,
to wise and fully functional.
Hi, Max.
But whatever their form, robots are a reflection of us. They are our creations. What science fiction on television says about them reveals even more about us. We will be back in a few minutes with more of the best in science fiction and fantasy when the Museum of Television and Radio special continues. Just ahead, Leonard Nimoy with a journey into nightmare worlds.